Hi everyone, Aaron here for zollotech, and today Apple released iOS 13.4 Developer Beta 2. This is available to developers and soon to public beta testers if it's not out already by the time of this video, but usually they release it later in the same day or the following day. With Beta 1, they actually waited a week, so it depends on what Apple decides to do, but by the time you're seeing this, chances are it's already out, or it will be soon. Now this came in at 460.3 megabytes on my iPhone 11 Pro Max, and very similarly sized on the iPhone 8 Plus that I have here, the iPhone 6S Plus, my iPad Pro 12.9 from 2018. I also installed it on the iPhone XR, and so we're going to take a look at some of those other things later on, but first I'll talk about the build number. So let's take a look at that. We'll take a look at some of the notes, features, fixes, and more. The build number is 17E5233G, and this particular build is about 10 builds newer than the previous beta that was released a couple weeks ago. So Apple's tweaking things, changing things, and I think they'll finally release this particular beta probably toward the end of March whenever they have that event. So it seems like they're fixing things, and along with this beta, Apple also released a macOS beta update as well as tvOS, and then yesterday they released a watchOS update with bug fixers, and I have a separate video on that because it was a public release. Now the first thing is Apple actually updated their notes this time, so there were 5 known issues that they reported. Those are basically the same as last time, but they also had one resolved issue, and that applies to the 12.9 iPad Pro. So if you're using the beta with the iPad Pro, there's several languages that had issues with hardware layouts matching them. And so Apple has actually updated it so that the languages now match the hardware keyboard layouts accurately. So if you were having issues with that, that's now resolved. Now, QuickType is something that I use often where you can just swipe to type in what you want. So if we do that with the word iCloud here, it fills that in. And so you'll see it filled in iCloud, and they've updated some of the predictive text and things like that. So the first thing is, the QuickType keyboard now supports predictive input for Arabic. It also supports live conversion for Japanese and Chinese, and then also supports Swiss German for the 12.9 iPad Pro. So that's really all they have as far as updates in the notes, but there's a few other things as well. Now, for those of you that were having issues with the notifications stacking on one another, that issue seems to be resolved now. So they're no longer stacking on one another as they fill up, and it seems to be working properly now. So no issues there. And then also mail, when you receive a notification that you have a new mail, it actually shows up properly now. So before it wasn't showing right away, it seems that that's been fixed. Now, finally, with the 6S Plus, I was having a few issues with bugs with it rotating to landscape or coming out of rotating to landscape. So currently you'll see I don't have the rotation lock turned on, but it won't rotate to landscape on the home screen. But when I went into Minecraft, it ran that without any problem, but then the whole screen was in landscape and it wouldn't come out of that until I closed it or shut it off, opened it back up, and then it would work. Now it's not working again. So I don't know what's going on with that. It seems to be an issue in this particular build, so I'll report it in the feedback app. Now, as far as features and changes, well, we saw most of those with the first beta, but there are quite a few tweaks and changes with this particular update. And thanks to my friend Steve over at Mac Rumors for helping me out with a few of these. I really appreciate it. And the first thing is there are new settings for TV options. So if we go into the settings app and then we go down to TV, there's new cellular options. So download options for cellular, there's audio language options. And so if we compare this to the previous version, with beta 1, it's actually quite a bit different. So this has more options within this settings page, and it's just something that they've updated. The next update has to do with mail. And if we go into mail, and within mail, they continually are tweaking the bar at the bottom with our different icons. So before we actually had a flag, and it's been replaced by compose. And if we want to get to the flag, we have to hit reply now. So that's been updated. They changed it from beta 1, as you can see here, and it's just tweaked a little bit. And I expect them to actually change it before it's actually released to the public. Maybe they'll tweak this again. It's hard to say. Now, there's something new if you have an iPhone with a home button that's haptic, such as the iPhone 8 Plus or 7 or 7 Plus. What we have here is some new text for the home button. So if we go to settings, We'll go to home button here, and you'll see here at the top, it says you can choose how the home button feels when you press it, select an option below and press the home button to try it out. This is new text compared to what we had before. And I suspect this is because Apple is getting ready for the iPhone 9 or iPhone SE 2, and maybe they just tweaked the text a little bit to seem a little bit more updated. But you can see here before this is what it said, and now it's been updated to what I just read. Now there's also support for additional mice. You can't actually see this, but there's support for additional mice within the code itself, and it supports the Corsair Harpoon and also the MX Anywhere too. So those are actually within the code. You just can't see it. So if you have one of those mice or mouse, you can actually check it out and see if it works for you. Also, there's some hints in the code with music stories. So in music, you can't find stories anywhere here or anything like that, but maybe under the For You tab in the future, they're going to have something called music stories, maybe about the artists or something along those lines. It's just mentioned in the code. There's nothing really that you can see visually though when it comes to that. Now there's a new message when you go into Assistive Touch. So if we go into our accessibility settings here, and then we go to touch and we turn on Assistive Touch, we'll get a message that pops up and says, Assistive Touch menu customization. Would you like to customize your top level Assistive Touch menu to include dwell and scroll? You hit customize and it pops up. If we go to a device that's on a prior beta or even iOS 13.3 or 13.3.3.1, you'll see touch, we go to Assistive Touch, turn it on. We just get the little icon that pops up. We don't get that message. So that will pop up every single time you turn on Assistive Touch. Now, again, in the code, there's some mentions of single app mode being renamed to assessment mode. Now, I've seen assessment mode in other code elsewhere or other places, but normally what you do is if you have single app mode, you would use your iPad, for example, in a kiosk where you would just want an app that relates to your business showing up regularly, or you could do that with your phone. They've renamed that to assessment mode. So I don't know if that's something that's going to change in the future or not, but that's what it seems to be right now. And then finally, the car key that was mentioned last time, car key that would mean you can use your phone as your car key for cars that use NFC technology, maybe using the tap to open or unlock, similar to maybe what a Tesla does, although I think that's RF, but it could be NFC as well, depending on which one you have. And this would allow you to do that. But something else has been found in the code that allows you to maybe share that car key through iMessage. So if you have that car key set up, we can't see that yet, but when Apple adds that, you'd be able to share that key with a friend through messages and allow them to have access to your vehicle for a set amount of time. So that's some things or features that we should see in the future, probably closer to the final release. As far as iPadOS, there's nothing new in iPadOS other than what I already mentioned. So all of the same tweaks and changes are available in iPadOS, but nothing particularly new or exciting. It's the exact same thing with the same sort of performance. Now, as far as RAM management is concerned, I did check this out on a couple different devices just to see how it went. And what I did to check RAM management or how quickly an app reloads when you reopen it, I opened 25 applications on my iPhone 11 Pro Max. I went back and forth, went to things like YouTube, waited for it to load, and then I went out of it, reloaded another app. And I did that 25 times. Then I waited 5 to 15 minutes, went back in, and didn't have it reload. So I'm actually seeing pretty good RAM management performance. I did the exact same test on the iPhone 6S Plus and came up with the same result. So if we go into the App Store, you'll see it reloaded there. That's the first time I let it sit. But if you don't let it sit, it actually would let me do 20 apps without a problem. So maybe RAM management is fixed. It's hard to say, but at this time, it looks great on my iPhone 11 Pro Max. Now, as far as battery is concerned, I saw pretty good results when it came to battery with iOS 13.4 Beta 1. If we go into settings, we'll take a look at my battery here. And with the follow-ups that I did, quite a few of you said it was good as well. You said it was the same as iOS 13.3.1 or better. Most of you, not everyone. But you'll see my battery health is at 100%. This will not go down because of an update. It's just rechecking your battery health every time. And so if it does go down, it's just because it rechecked it and it physically degraded. Now, if we go to the last 10 days, we'll just take a look at yesterday. I had 3 hours and 10 minutes of screen on time, 1 hour and 59 minutes of screen off time. And I used this for a little over 25% of the battery. So it actually did pretty good. Screen off time is basically when you're playing music in the background and things like that. So in general, it's doing pretty well on battery. If I was to use this until the battery reached zero, I'd get about 12 hours of screen on time with it. So it's doing really well on the 11 Pro Max. Now, as far as performance, I did play around with it quite a bit for about an hour or so on the 11 Pro Max. I had no issues with performance. I noticed no slowdowns and no app crashes, with the exception of Maps on the iPhone 6S Plus. I found Maps actually crashed the first time I opened it, but performance in general seemed good. I actually played Minecraft for a moment just to see how it would go. We'll wait for it to load again, but I had this loaded in memory and you'll see it just popped back up. So it's actually performing well. I didn't see any frame rate slowdowns or anything like that. And in general, it was reacting how I expected. So I sort of use Minecraft as a benchmark, and you'll see this is what I was talking about before. Now it's stuck in landscape mode. I can't go to home or can't go to portrait. If I turn the phone off, turn it back on, it's back to normal, but I can't rotate it again. I'm not sure why it's doing that, but that seems to be a bug. So like I said, I'll report it in the feedback app. Now let's take a look at the Geekbench scores. I ran it on quite a few devices this time, so we'll go into Geekbench 5. Some people had different results. I find that it's pretty good in general, but let's go to history here and we'll take a look at what I ran just a moment ago. You'll see I scored 1,328 for single core, 3,323 for multi-core. If we take a look at the history here, we'll go down to February 5th. I scored very similarly, a little bit less, but that much of a difference really isn't something you're going to notice with regular use. You may see this go up over time as well. It's really hard to say, but in general, it seemed to be about the same. Now let's take a look at the Geekbench scores on all of these devices. Now on the left, I have the iPad Pro 12.9, then I have the iPhone 6S Plus, then the iPhone 8 Plus, then the iPhone 10R, and then the iPhone 11 Pro Max. And as you can see, all of the different scores here should give you some representation of what your phone should be like as far as its scores are concerned, if you're keeping track. So if you're around these numbers, it should be performing about the same. That's it for iOS 13.4 Beta 2, and I'm really looking forward to the final release of this, which I think is going to be around March 31st, if all of the information is correct about when Apple will have their next event. So if they have their event around then, expect the final release by then, and I think this update will bring a lot of stability to people looking for a better experience with less issues, because Beta 1 was pretty good, so I expect Beta 2 to be even better. Now, as far as Beta 3, the actual release of that, I would expect that to be out probably in 1 to 2 weeks. I'm not sure if we're in a 1 or 2 week cycle. Early on, so far, we're in a 2 week cycle, but closer to the final release, we get to a 1 week cycle. So it's hard to say. And then we'll see major feature updates with iOS 14 in June. And that's really all there is with this beta. But if I find anything else, I'll do a follow-up with all of the other features that are found later on, if I do find anything. And if you've found anything, let me know in the comments below. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description as I always do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.